Are force and mass fundamental? Can we do mechanics without postulating Newton's laws of motion and without even postulating mass? If you think the answer is no, you're in for a surprise. This is perhaps the first system we study after being introduced to Newtonian mechanics, elastic collision of two particles in one dimension. As you probably know, we typically resolve it using energy and momentum conservation. But what if I tell you it could be resolved just from symmetries without ever invoking Newtonian mechanics, force, mass, energy, momentum, conservation laws, and everything that follows from them? But how to even measure how different two particles are without postulating mass in the first place? As we'll see in the video, the concept of mass can fall out of the equations based on symmetry principles without ever being postulated. But how do we even approach something like this? Where do we even begin? We are essentially being asked to create a theory of mechanics from scratch. And I think the first place to look is what we expect to be true of the laws of nature themselves. Things like changing units of measurement should not change the laws of physics, neither should changing frame of reference or the direction of space and time. Using these four symmetry principles, not only can we resolve this system, but those which involve more than two particles as well, a system which happens to be non-deterministic in Newtonian mechanics. We'll also recover a version of Newton's first law and the concept of mass in the process. Like any complex problem, let's start with the simplest variant first. Let's consider the behavior of a single point particle as it hits a wall in one dimension. Can we find the final velocity of the particle as some function of initial velocity, say f? Think of f as some law of physics that we are trying to find. If we can find some reasonable way to constrain it, we could get started. What if we reverse the direction of space? The initial and final velocities of the particle would then appear to be negative u and negative v respectively. But shouldn't the laws of physics remain the same whether the particle is moving from left to right or right to left? This property of being invariant in all directions is called isotropy, and this is our first postulate. The laws of physics remain the same in all the directions. This means that the axis reversed case should follow the same law f as the initial case. That is, negative v equals f of negative u. We can substitute v from the initial equation to get this relation. This does constrain f to odd functions, but it's not nearly enough to pin it down. Notice how the arguments and results of f do not include units, only the values of initial and final velocities. But what if we change the units from meters per second to centimeters per second? The initial and final velocities would then be 100 u and 100 v centimeters per second respectively. But shouldn't the laws of physics remain same irrespective of our units of measurement? So the same law f should apply in the new units as well, which gives us f of 100 u equals 100 v. But since we can switch to any arbitrary units, we can put any factor k greater than 0 instead of 100. This is our second postulate, that the laws of physics remain same under a change of units. We'll call it scale invariance. We can use the result from isotropy to get this to hold for any k instead of just k greater than 0. Notice how if we put u equals 1 in the relation, we get f of k equals k times f of 1. So we managed to pin down f from any arbitrary function to linear ones passing through origin. All we need to do now is find f of 1. Let's consider a slightly modified setup. Let's say we put the particle in between two walls with initial velocity of 1 unit. Let's say the velocity of the particle after each successive collision becomes v1, v2, v3 and so on. So we can find the final velocity after nth collision as f of 1 raised to the power n. So if the absolute value of f of 1 is greater than 1, then after each successive collision, we'll see the particle increasing in speed as shown here. But if this was the case in reality, we would observe things like gases in completely isolated containers spontaneously heating up to extreme temperatures as the particles collide with the walls. And if the absolute value of f of 1 was less than 1, the speed would decrease after each collision, as you can see here. In this case, gases in completely isolated container would spontaneously cool down to near absolute zero. Our next postulate will avoid these contradictions along with explaining Newton's first law of motion. Let's consider what happens if we reverse the direction of time. The particle would hit the wall with an initial velocity of v and then go off with final velocity u. This brings us to our third postulate, time reversal symmetry. Similar to how the laws of physics do not change with a reversal in direction of space, they should not change with a reversal in direction of time as well. This means that the time reversed case would follow the same laws of physics, the law being f here, as the initial case. That is, f of u equals v implies f of v equals u. We can substitute v to get f of u equals u. Let's see how time reversal symmetry can enforce Newton's first law of motion. Consider an isolated particle traveling at velocity v. If the particle were to spontaneously speed up over time, we would have dv by dt greater than 0. But in the reversed case, the particle would appear to slow down. This violates time symmetry. Similarly, if the particle were to spontaneously slow down over time, that is dv by dt less than 0, that would violate time symmetry by the same logic. This means that the only possible case is that the particle keeps moving with the same velocity, unless it interacts with something else. This is equivalent to Newton's first law of motion. And with that, we are now ready to resolve f. By time symmetry, we have f of 1 equals 1. We can apply scale invariance to get f of 1 times f of 1 equals 1. That means f of 1 equals 1 or f of 1 equals minus 1. That means either f of u equals negative u or f of u equals to u. Both of these are valid solutions under the postulates of isotropy, time reversal symmetry and scale invariance. In the first case, the particle collides with the wall and goes back with equal and opposite velocity. In the second case, the particle transmits through the wall without interacting with it. Let's consider the collision of two identical particles now. Let's say the initial velocities are x and y units, and the corresponding final velocities are u and v units respectively. We need to find u and v as some functions of x and y. Just like previous example, we'll think of f and g as some laws of physics that we are trying to find. Now let's see what happens if we swap their labels. We'll call the first particle 2 and the second particle 1. The initial velocities would then be y and x, and the final velocities would be v and u respectively. But the laws of physics remain the same. In fact, the experiment remains the same. It does not matter what we call these particles. That means v equals f of y x and u equals g of y x. This is called permutation symmetry. It means any permutation of identical objects does not change anything. We can substitute v from the original equations to get this relation. Thus, we only need to find f in order to resolve this collision. Now let's consider the experiment from a moving frame of reference. In this frame of reference, the initial velocities would appear to be x minus r and y minus r respectively. And the final velocities would also appear to be v minus r and u minus r respectively. But shouldn't the laws of physics remain same in all frames of references? That gives us v minus r equals f of y minus r and x minus r for all r. And similarly, u minus r equals g of y minus r and x minus r for all r. This is called frame invariance. It means that the laws of physics do not change under a change of frame of reference. And this is our last postulate. We can substitute v to get this relation. Just like the previous example, we can switch to any arbitrary units and get the relation f of kx and ky equals k times f of x and y. Similarly, the time reverse case should follow the same laws. That is, f of u and v equals x and g of u and v equals y. We are now ready to resolve f and g. We can use frame and scale invariance to show that f is a linear function with no constant term and the sum of coefficients being equal to 1, as shown here. Let's save this result and apply permutation symmetry. Just like the previous example, we just need to find f of 1, 0 in order to find f and g. And we can use time reversal symmetry to do that. We get f of u v equals x. We apply our linearity relation to get this equation. But we can substitute u and v again to get this complex looking relation. We simplify it a bit to get this relation. Note that time reversal symmetry holds for all collisions. This means this relation should hold for all x and y. The only way this relation holds for all x and y is if the coefficients match. So we get these two relations that we can use to find the value of p. We can simplify it and we find p either equals 0 or 1. We can substitute the two values of p to find two sets of solutions for f and g. One corresponds to collision and the other corresponds to transmission. So either the particles do not interact with each other at all and pass through, or they just swap their initial velocities after the collision. These are the only two possible solutions that remain same under a change in direction, units of measurement, direction of time, or frame of reference. In the next section, we'll consider collision of three or more identical particles, and we'll see how co-located particles simulate mass. Let's say the initial velocities are x, y, z and the final velocities are u, v, w. Like always, we need to find three functions corresponding to the final velocities. Notice that unlike previous examples, this one cannot be solved through momentum and energy conservation. We have three variables corresponding to the final velocities, but conservation laws only give us two constraints, thus leaving 1 degree of freedom undetermined. Let's apply permutation symmetry to simplify it a bit. Nothing changes for the first particle if we swap the second and third particles, so we get this relation. If we swap first and second particle, the final velocities would swap as well, giving us this relation. And if we swap the first and third particle, the final velocities would swap as well, giving us this relation. Thus, we just need to find F in order to find G and H as well. We can apply frame invariance to get this relation and scale invariance to get this relation. We can use these two relations from frame and scale invariance to show that F is a linear function with sum of coefficients equals to 1 and no constant term. If you want to see the full proof, you can check out the link in the description. By permutation symmetry, nothing changes for the first particle's final velocity if we swap the second and third particle, thus giving us this relation. We can simplify it to find that B equals C. Thus, we can write f of x, y, z in this form. All we need to do now is find the values of A and B, and we'll have our functions f, g, and h. And like always, we'll apply time symmetry to do that. Let's say the second particle is at rest, and the first and third particle come at it with equal and opposite velocities, say p and minus p. And let's say the final velocities are q, r, and s respectively. We can show that the final velocities of the first and third particle would still be equal and opposite, and the second particle would still be at rest after the collision. Now we can apply time symmetry to get this relation. We can substitute f with the linear relation to get this, and we can substitute q with the initial equation to get this relation. Thus, either a minus b equals 1 or a minus b equals minus 1. We can solve for the values of a and b to get two sets of solution, either b equals 0 and a equals 1 or b equals 2 by 3 and a equals minus 1 by 3, thus giving us two solutions for f of x, y, z. Like always, one corresponds to collision and the other to transmission. But something very special happens when two of the three particles are co-moving. Let's say the initial velocities are x, y, and y, and the final velocities are u, v, and w. We can use our result for the collision of three particles to find the final velocities u, v, and w. As you can see, w equals v. So if the particles are co-moving before the collision, they would be co-moving after the collision as well. But what's so special about this result? Well, this is the exact result we get from Newtonian mechanics elastic collision of two particles of mass 1 and 2 respectively. It's as if the two co-moving particles are behaving as one particle of twice the mass. Now let's see what happens when we consider simultaneous collision of n identical particles instead of just three. We can rewrite the result for final velocity of the first particle this way: twice the average velocity of the three particles minus the velocity of the first particle. And we get the same result when we have n particles instead of three. We can follow the exact steps that we did for three particles in order to prove this relation. I have linked the full proof in the description. But if we consider the special case, when a bunch of these particles are traveling together with initial velocity x and the rest of them have some initial velocity y, we get the final velocity of the first particle as this big thing. We'll write it in short using the capital F. We'll say f of n1, n2, x, and y. It means that n1 particles are moving together with some velocity x and n2 particles are moving together with some velocity y. We can apply our result for the n particle collision to get this final velocity of the first particle. We can group the terms based on common velocities to get this final result. And this is the exact result we get from Newtonian mechanics from elastic collision of two particles of mass n1 and n2. While we never postulated mass in the first place, we have co-moving particles simulating mass exactly in agreement with Newtonian mechanics, all from our four symmetry principles. In this video, we saw how apparently innocent assumptions about the nature of universe can have far-reaching consequences. We also learned how what we think of as fundamental could just be a model of reality that happens to explain it very well. So are force and mass fundamental? Let me know what you think in the comments.